So, welcome to all of you in lecture 10, which is on topic work and heat transfer. This is the second lecture on work and heat transfer topic. So, we move in this lecture. In the last class, we have already discussed about path function. Okay, we have taken example of work transfer, which is the best example of path function. It is depends upon path that whatever the value of work we will get in particular problem. Today we discuss what is point function. So point function thermodynamics properties are point function. The change in thermodynamic property of a system in a change of state is independent from the path which is followed during the state and depends only on initial and final states of the system. Okay, so we discuss this point through board. Okay, I am trying to discuss on board this. Okay, so let us discuss about what is point function. Okay, suppose we take a PV diagram of a particular cycle. This is a cycle. Okay, suppose like that. This is one state and this is second state. This is path A. Yeah, okay. We can disindicate paths. If we transfer a state from 1 to 2, then this path is known as A, and if we will move towards second to first, then this path is known as B. Okay, so right now if we talk about work transfer in these two paths, so we clearly understand this in previous lecture that WA is greater than WB. The first condition is that WA does not equal to WB, and second condition is that WA is greater than WB. How we get these conclusions? Because we know that work is depends upon path. Okay, so if we consider a path which is connecting state 1 to state 2, and if we take in area under this curve, so clearly we see this is the work transfer when we move towards state 2 from state 1 through a path A. Okay, and if we want to calculate work transfer when we move towards second state to first state through path B, then we get this work transfer value. Okay, by these horizontal lines we get. So clearly we can understand that area under curve of path A is greater than in compared to area under curve of path B. That's why we can say that WA is greater than in compared to WB. So this is the example which we discussed deeply in the last class. But today we talk about point function. So if we taken again this example, See, again we draw this cycle in PV diagram. We already defined what is cycle. Cycle is a define in which initial and final points are coincident. Okay, so if we starting from this point in this cycle, so we move towards first to second, and after that, after reaching this second state, we will move again towards one to this path. So if we combine these two paths, then we can see that here first is the initial point, and after moving to these two paths, we again reach on first point again. Okay, so we can say that in this particular case, initial and final points are coincident. So that's why by combining these two parts, we can maintain, we can make this cycle. Okay, so this is about cycle definition, which we have already discussed in first chapter, that is basic concept of thermodynamics. Now, what is point function? Point function means if properties of thermodynamics depends upon only on states, okay, whatever we value at one and whatever we value b, and that is independent from the path history which it was followed, okay, during transformation of state. So such type of properties are known as point function dependence properties. Okay, so if we take an example of internal energy, okay, U, that is internal energy of the system. Okay, we will discuss this point in detail when we will understand concept of first law of thermodynamics. Okay, so here we just consider this term, and for understanding the this concept point function, so I am telling you that just assume that this U term is internal energy of the system which is kept inside the system in the form of energy. Okay, so if we talk about this value at state point one, this is U1, okay, and at second point, that's it, that is U2. So if we talk about change in internal energy when this system is going through path A, so what is change in internal energy? That is delta U through A when we move towards first to second, that is equal to U2 minus U1. Okay, and if we calculate delta U for path transformation B, that is from second to first, that is equal to U1 minus U2. Okay, so by this mathematical expansion, we can understand that these two values in magnitude are same. Okay, if we talk about, I'm just talking about in magnitude only, because here U1 minus U2 having some value with minus sign, and U2 minus U1, that is the positive value. If internal energy is increasing from 1 to 2 point. Okay. So if this value having some magnitude x, then this is this value having some value x, then in path B, internal energy that is equal to something value minus x. Okay. But if we talk about only magnitude, then both cases will have same magnitude of internal energy. Okay. We take another example. Suppose corresponding to this first state, volume is V1. Okay. And corresponding to this second state, that is volume V2. So if we talk about change in volume through path A, what is that value? That is delta V for A from 1 to 2, that is equal to V2 minus V1. Okay. And if we change this direction, because some students having confusion regarding this magnitude and this sign value. So in this second example, I'm changing the direction of this B path. So in both paths, we are moving towards 1 to 2 through A, and through B, we are also moving towards 1 to 2. Okay. So we, in this case, we disregard the concept of cycle. We just consider two different paths which having same direction. So if we moving 1 to 2 through a path A, then change in volume is known as V2 minus V1. Okay. If we moving 1 to 2 with path B, then again we calculate change in volume through 1 to 2, that is equal to V2 minus V1 again. So what conclusion here? That in both cases, we have same value of change in volume. Doesn't matter in which path you are moving from one to second state. So this is the another example which tells about point function, that volume, change in internal energy, these properties do not depend upon path history. These property depends only on whatever the initial and final stages. Okay. So like that, pressure, temperature, these are all of depends upon points value. These are independent from the path history. Okay. If we talk about change in pressure, if we talk about change in temperature, if we talk about change in internal energy, if we talk about change in volume, these all of depends upon what at particular state this property having value. And if we want to calculate change in that value from 1 to 2, simply you separate these value U2 minus U1 or V2 minus V1 or T2 minus T1 or P2 minus P1. In this changement, there is no role of path history. Okay. So that's all about point function. We again move towards our slide. So this is the problem. This is the slide above. So the differentials of point function are exact. We already discussed in the last lecture that path function having inexact differential. But if we talk about point function, these function having exact differential. So since we have already discussed about exact and inexact differential in the last lecture, so we move again towards next point. So if we talk about the total volume change during a process between state 1 to 2, okay,
So this is dv equals to v2 minus v1. If we calculate this value through integration, then we apply limits from 1 to 2 and we get change in volume during transformation of state 1 to 2. Okay. So change in volume does depends only on the end states of the system irrespective of the path of the system follows. We already discussed that. Okay. So in this example, I am comparing between path function and point function values. So in this example, we see that change in volume, if we moving towards path A, is equal to 3 m³. And if we moving towards path B from state 1 to state 2, again we get change in volume that is equal to 3 m³. But if we talk about work transfer through these paths, path A and path B, we get different values. If we moving towards path A from state 1 to state 2, we get 8 kJ. But if we move through 1 to 2 with the path B, then we get 12 kJ. That means WB is greater than W1. And if we adopt area under curve method for calculating this work transfer, then clearly we can understand that area under curve with path B is greater than in compared to path A. That's why we see in this example WB is greater than WA. Okay. So work done in a quasi-static process between two given states depends upon path followed. We already discussed that work is defined as indication of PdV for a closed system, and this expression is valid only for quasi-static process. We already discussed in the last lecture, for a cyclic process, the initial and final state of the system are the same. Hence, the change in end property is zero. I want to teach you through this board. See that here we talk about change in property in a cyclic process. Okay, so suppose this is a PV diagram and this is a cycle. This is state 1 and state 2. This is A and this is B. Okay. So in this cycle, if we starting from one state, so we move towards second state and again we move from second state to first state. So if we want to calculate net change in volume in throughout the cycle, so what is that? That is delta V for cycle is equal to V1 minus V1, that is equal to zero. Because if we starting and end points are same, then change in volume or change in temperature or change in pressure, that must be equal to zero. Okay. Same thing is happening if we talk about, this is the case of delta V for a cyclic, this is the sign of cyclic interior. Okay, that is equal to zero. And same thing is happening in temperature and again for pressure. Okay, because your initial and final states are same. If we want to calculate change in property from 1 to 2, then you simply put limit on integration, that is 1 to 2, and we get final answer that is equal to V2 minus V1. But what about 1 to 1? That means this is a cyclic interior. That's why we put here integration sign with cycle. Okay. So in that case, always remember that change in property of a system for a cycle is must be equal to zero. Okay. So again, we move towards our slide. So that's all about point function. Now we move different processes work, PDB work in various process. I'm using here term quasi-static process because we talk about PDB work. And we know that this expansion PDB is only valid for quasi-static process because we need a well-defined path. And for getting well-defined path, we need lots of equilibrium points. And we get lots of intermediate equilibrium points between initial and final states only in the case of quasi-static process, which is following in a very slow manner. Okay, so let us discuss how we get this PDB work in different type of process. So I note down these process one by one, and then we deeply discuss that how can we get these values in particular different process. So first one, we talk about isobaric process. Isobaric. Then we talk about isochoric. Then we talk about isothermal. And then that is polytopic. Okay. So one by one, we will discuss this. See, if we talk about isobaric process, what is meaning isobaric process? Isobaric meaning that is constant pressure process. Okay. Isobaric mean pressure equals to constant. Okay. So if we plot PV diagram for this process, so it is like that. If anybody is moving, any process is moving towards one state to second state. So in this case, volume is changing. Volume is changing from V1 to V2, but pressure is maintained constant throughout the process. So if we want to calculate work transfer from state 1 to state 2, so if we apply work transfer expression for this particular case, so what we get? We know that work transfer for particular these two states is our indication of PDB. And here, pressure is a constant term and volume is changing. So what are the limits of this volume? These limits are V1 to V2. Okay. So if we solve this expansion, we get P and indication of dV that is equal to V, and here lower limit is V1 and upper limit is V2. So we get final expansion that is equal to P V2 minus V1. Okay. So this is the expansion for isobaric process work done. Now we move towards isochoric process. Isochoric process. So what is isochoric process? This is the process in which volume is constant. Okay. So if we plot PV diagram for this expansion, it is like that. Okay. This is state 1 and this is state 2. And here V1 is equal to V2. Okay. P1 is different. Yeah, this value having P1 and this value is P2, but volume is constant. So if we apply work expansion W1 to 2, that is equal to
integration of V1 to V1, okay? Because volume is a constant, PdV. So that must be equal to zero, because both limits are same, and that's why here in this expression dV that is equal to zero. So by this expression we can understand then for a closed system in isochoric process we get zero work done. Remember this, we calculate here all types of work for a closed system. Remember this always. Here we talk about these all types of work done in a closed system. Okay. We will discuss open system work done after this expression. Okay. So here we talk about closed system work done. So this is about work done in isobaric process and isochoric process. Now we move towards work done in a closed system for isothermal process. So as we know that for isothermal process, PV equals to constant term existing. Okay. We know that for isothermal process, PV equals to constant term existing. Okay. This expression we use for a particular case in which temperature is a constant. Okay. Because by ideal gas equation, we know that PV upon T equals to constant. And if this is the case in which temperature is maintained constant throughout the change event for a particular process in which state is changing from 1 to 2. So we can say that temperature is constant. Then we get only expansion in varying term that is equal to PV equals to constant. Okay. So for isothermal process, we know that PV equals to constant. So if we want to calculate work done in an isothermal process, then if we adopt, firstly, I am drawing here PV diagram for the isothermal process. So like that, this curve having some slope. Okay. This is the one point and this is the second point. This is the isothermal expansion. Okay, so if we adopt expression for getting work done in this particular isothermal process, so W1 to 2, that is equal to integration from V1 to V2 PdV. So here problem is that if we want to calculate this integration, so we should remove this pressure term, because in this expression, pressure is also varying and volume is also varying. Okay. Here, two terms are varying. So that's why we have to remove this pressure and we put this pressure value in terms of volume. Okay. So how we get? We adopt this expression. PV equals to constant. We know here pressure is a varying term and volume is also varying term, and we put value P equals to C upon V. Okay. Now we put this pressure value in terms of volume in our work done expansion. Then what we get? W1 to 2, that is equal to integration from V1 to V2. That is the value of pressure C upon V. And with integration dV. Okay. So if we calculate this value, here C is a constant term. So we can put this constant term outside the integration and we get value C integration of 1 upon V with limits V1 to V2. So this value is equal to V2 to the power minus 1 And if we adopt this value to integration, so what we get? That is equal to V minus N plus 1. Okay? We get this value. Sorry. We get this value here. This is a constant term. Integration of V1 to V2. 1 upon V dV. That is equal to C ln V2 upon V1. Okay. By solving this integration, we get this value. C ln V2 upon V1. Because 1 upon x integration in terms of dx, that is equal to ln x. Okay. So if we put this constant term value, what is this constant term value? That is equal to PV. So if we want to put this value to the coordinates term value, to the state terms value, so we can say for this transformation, C equals to, that is equal to P1 V1. We can put this value P1 V1 or we can put P2 V2. Okay. So if we define this word transfer from 1 to 2, then we put these value in this expansion. So we get P1 V1 ln V2 upon V1. Okay. Or you can say W1 to 2 P2 V2 ln V2 upon V1. And again, for isothermal process, P1 V1 equals to P2 V2. Okay. So if we want to replace this term in terms of pressure ratio, so we have to find a value of this volume ratio in terms of pressure ratio. So if we consider this expansion, we get V2 upon V1, that is equal to P1 upon P2. So if we put this value, we get P1 V1 ln P1 upon P2 or P2 V2 ln P1 upon P2. So these are the work done expression for an isothermal process. Okay. So in some problems, you will get initial pressure and volume value and final pressure value. So in that case, if you want to calculate work transfer from state 1 to 2, so you have to use this expansion, because on that particular problem, you will not getting value of volume ratio. You get only pressure ratio and initial volume value. So you have to consider this expansion. So according to problem, whatever the given values are there, you have to choose which expression is useful for you at particular problem to calculate isothermal work done. Okay. So these are the four expressions by which you can calculate work done value in a isothermal process. Okay. Now we're moving towards calculating polytopic process work done. So polytopic process, first question is that what is polytopic process? All of you are aware with the term adiabatic process. Okay. So what is adiabatic process? Adiabatic process is a process in which heat transfer is zero from system to surrounding or surrounding to system. But if we talk about intermediate process between isothermal and adiabatic process, okay, such a process in which pressure is varying, temperature is varying, volume is varying, and heat transfer is also
taking role on that particular transformation. So such type of process in which heat transfer is taking place, pressure, change in pressure is taking place, volume is taking, change in volume is taking place, okay, change in temperature is taking place. So such type of process is known as polytropic process. So you can say, in other words, that polytropic process is a very generalized process in which all coordinates, all thermodynamics properties are changing from state 1 to state 2, as well as heat transfer is also taking place on that particular process. So for that process, remember this adiabatic process, or you can say that isentropic process is a particular case of polytropic process. Okay, it is a special case of polytropic process in which we limit the heat transfer from system to surrounding, and that is equal to zero. Okay, so here we are talking about polytropic process. So what is polytropic process? In which all terms is going on changing phase. Okay, so if we talk about generalized expression for polytropic process, it is like PV equals to N equals to constant. If you remember that, if we want to talk about general expression for adiabatic process, that is something like PV equals to gamma, PV to the power gamma equals to constant. Okay, if you remember this, and here if we talk about gamma value for air, that is equal to 1.4. So here gamma is defined as Cp upon Cv, that is specific heat ratio at constant pressure and constant volume. You have already learned this term in 10 plus 2 level. Okay, so here we talk about polytropic process in which N is a generalized term. Okay, it may be equal to gamma, or it may be equal to, if N equals to 1, this process becomes isothermal process. Okay, because we know that PV equals to constant for isothermal process, that means in isothermal process, N value is equal to 1. So if we talk about this polytropic process, this is a generalized process, then if we want to calculate work transfer from 1 to 2, suppose this is a PV diagram for this particular process, this is a volume V1 and this is a V2. State is changing from state 1 to state 2, and this is a pressure P1 and this is a pressure P2. Okay, and if this is a generalized term, then maybe there is something heat transfer is taking place during the state change from 1 to 2. Okay, so if you want to calculate W1 to 2, then what is that? Is integration of PdV. Okay, and here we put limits, that is volume, in terms of volume, that is equal to V1 to V2. So how we calculate this value? Then again, like isothermal process, we have to remove this pressure term, and we put this pressure term value in terms of volume. So if we consider this expression, PV to the power N equals to constant, PV to the power N equals to constant, and if we put pressure value in terms of volume, then what do we get? We get P equals to C upon V to the power N. Okay, where C is a constant term. So if we put this value, W12 is equal to V1 upon V1 to V2, and this value, that is equal to C upon V2 to power N, and with integration of dV. Okay, so if we calculate this integration value, then what we get? We put this C value outside the integration and reduce this term, that is integration from V1 to V2, 1 upon V2 to power N and dV.
After solving this value, we get C that is V to the power minus n plus 1 upon minus n plus 1 upper limit that is V2 and lower limit that is V1. Okay. So this is the expansion from W212. If we solve again and reduce this term, so I'm writing here. Okay. So if we put value of C, we can put this value P1 V1 to the power n or P2 V2 to the power n. Okay. We can put this value here. So W12 that is equal to P1 V1 to the power n. Here, firstly, I am putting here P1 V1 to the power n for a C case. So inside the expansion, we get value of volume that is equal to V2 1 minus n minus V1 1 minus n. Okay. So for reducing this term, okay, we can product of these two terms with respective pressure value. Okay. See, firstly, I multiply this expression with minus sign and divide with minus sign. Okay. So this expression will change in terms of P1 V1 to the power n that is equal to n minus 1 V1 to the power 1 minus n minus V2 to the power 1 minus n. Here I am multiplying with minus sign and as well as dividing with minus sign in this expansion. So we get this term. Okay. Now we product these two terms. We get P1. If we multiply these two terms, V1 to the power n multiplied by V1 to the power 1 minus n, then we get P1 multiplied by V1. That means if base are same, then powers must be added. So in that case, n plus 1 minus n, n to n cancel, and we get P1, V1. Like same, if we want to multiply with this V2 term, then we are multiplying with this term, P2, V2 to the power n. Because here volume is a term. If we multiply this V1 term, then unnecessary terms are adding in our final expansion. So if we want to reduce the terms in a final expansion, then we have to multiply with the same terms value. Okay, so here we can put C value that is equal to P2 V2 to the power n. So if we multiply this term with this expansion, so P2 is the same and V2 to the power n multiplied by V2 to the power 1 minus n, we get V2, okay, upon n minus 1. So this is the final expansion for polytopic process. If there is, it is a adiabatic process, then simply you can replace this n term with gamma. Okay. So whatever we value, you can calculate by putting this expansion if process is a polytopic process. Okay, what n value. So you can convert this expression in terms of pressure ratio, or you can convert this term in terms of volume ratio. Okay, as your choice. Okay, so that's all about different types of process work when system is a closed system. Okay, now we move again towards our slide. Yes, so we have already discussed these process.
So now we discuss some problems which is based on these concept. And the last term, I already told you this problem. So today we discuss solution of this problem. The problem is that, again I am repeating, that an electric motor drives a stator fitted with a horizontal cylinder. The cylinder of 40 centimeter diameter contains a fluid restrained by a frictionless piston. During the stirring of fluid for 15 minutes, the piston moves outward slowly by a distance of 30 centimeters against the atmospheric pressure of 1 bar. The current supplied to the motor is 0.5 ampere from a 24 lead acid accumulator. If the conversion efficiency from the electric work to mechanical work output is a 90%, estimate the work done on the motor, stirrer and the atmosphere. Okay. So we have to calculate three types of work. What is the work done on the motor? What is the work done on stirrer? And what is the work done on the atmosphere? Okay. So let us see in which manner we solve this problem. So, firstly, I am calculating value of work done by the motor. Okay, here three types of term. First one is motor. Okay, this is an electric motor. Okay, by getting electricity, it is producing some power. Okay, and this power is transferring towards stator. Okay, this power is transferring towards stator, and this stator is rotating a fan inside the fluid. So this work is transferred inside the fluid. Okay, if I am trying to draw a figure, it is just like that. Okay. Here, this is a motor, electric motor. Okay, and this electric motor is connecting with battery. Okay, this is positive and this is negative. We are connecting this with motor, and this motor is connected with the stator, and throughout this side, fluid is placed. Okay, so like that problem. So firstly, we have calculate what is the work input inside the motor. Okay, what is the work input? This work, which is transferring inside the motor from the battery. Okay, lead acid battery, yeah, accumulator. Okay, so how we get this value? We know that power P equals to V into I. Okay, here P, that is the power input. Power input, what is unit of that? That unit is power unit is watt, or you can say watt, or you can say that is joule per second. Okay, that means power is defined as rate of work done. Okay, so this is a V into I. V, that is the voltage, and I, that is the current. Okay, so if we want to calculate work from the power, then you must be know that how much time duration this motor is working, or you can say that how much time motor absorb energy from the battery or from the accumulator, because
we know that power is defined as work upon time. Okay, so if we want to calculate work, then that must be equal to power multiplied by time. Okay, so we know that power is a product of voltage and current. Then if we want to calculate work input inside the motor, then we have to calculate product of V multiply I multiply by T. Here T, that is a time period. V, that is the voltage. And I, that is the current. Okay. Then you get
what is the input work inside the motor.
Okay. So if we calculate this in problem, what we get? There is a 24 lead acid accumulator. That means voltage value is given in this problem. That is equal to 24 multiplied by, okay, current value is given, I, that is 0.5 ampere. Okay. And how much time? 15 minutes. During the stirring of fluid, 15 minutes, piston moves outward slowly by a distance of 30 centimeters. That means time period is 15 minutes. But you have to put time value in second in this expression, because you are calculating work done in joule. So that's why if you are calculating work done in joule, then you have to put value of time in second. In this expression, then 15 minutes multiplied by 60. Here I am converting this minutes into second. So after calculating this term, we get value of work done, that is equal to 10,800 joule. Okay, that is work input motor. So we calculate this value. This work is going inside the motor
from the accumulator. Okay, now
this work problem is given that electrical work to mechanical work output is 90%. Okay, so here we getting this electric, but if this motor, what is motor role in this problem? Motor is converting electric power into mechanical power. Okay, so here it is taking electric power as an input. Electric power, electric work, and output of this motor is mechanical work. Okay, so input is electric work and output is a mechanical work. So by this mechanical work, this problem,
motor is trying to rotate stator. Okay,
so here a conversion factor is given in this problem, that is equal to 90%. Okay, that means motor is not 100% efficient. Some energy losses are taken place inside the motor due to frictional losses, due to other V and TL losses. And that's why mechanical work of motor, that is equal to input 10,800 multiplied by 9.9, because here 90% energy is converted into mechanical work. So if we calculate this value, that is equal to, I am converting here this value into kilojoule. Okay, so 9.72 kilojoule. Remember this, we get this value is equal to in joule. So if we convert this joule into kilojoule, then we have to divide with 1000. So after dividing this term, we get 9.72 kilojoule. So this is the stirrer work. Okay. Stirrer mechanical work.
That's a stirrer work. Now, in a final term, we have to calculate what is the work done on the atmosphere. Okay. So here, for calculating this term, this is a situation in which a cylinder of 40 centimeter diameter contains a fluid restricted by a frictionless piston. Okay. So here, a piston cylinder assembly is placed. Okay. That is like that. So when this stirrer is moving, so this fluid is trying to move this piston against the atmospheric pressure. Okay, like that. So if you want to calculate atmospheric pressure work, so this is equal to integration of P multiplied by delta V. Okay, so here, what is pressure value?
Because we are doing work against the atmosphere, then we have to measure pressure value of atmosphere. What is pressure value of atmosphere?
That is given 1 bar. Okay. So if we convert this 1 bar into SI unit, that is equal to 10 to power 5 Pascal.
So this is 10 to power 5 Pascal multiplied by change in volume. So what is change in volume? In a piston case, suppose this is a piston assembly. Okay. And this is the first condition. And this is the final condition. Second. Okay. If you want to
calculate change in volume. So in initial condition,
if this length is L1, and final condition, if this length is L2, so what is delta V? Delta V is equal to V2 minus V1. So for a cylinder, what is volume? Pi by 4 D square multiplied by H. So in first case, that is here, height is L2. So pi by 4 D square is a constant term. Here D, that is the diameter of a piston, multiply by, in a starting, in second state, height is L2, and in first state, that is height is L1. So this is the volume change of cylinder, that is pi by 4 D square L2 minus L1 during expansion process or during whatever be compression process. So this is the example of expansion process. So if we put this value here, you have value of diameter of piston, that is 0.4 meter. So pi by 4, 0.4 meter square, multiply by. Here in problem, is given that piston moves outwards slowly by a distance of 30 centimeter against the atmospheric pressure of 1 bar. That means, inside the problem, you know this value, L2 minus L1. L2 minus L1, that is equal to 30 centimeter. Okay, this is a given
inside the problem. So if you convert this 30 centimeter in meter and put this value in this expansion, that is 0.3, then you will get final work done value, that is equal to 3.77 kilojoule. Here you get value, this is the value of joule. Okay, by dividing 1000, you get this value in kilojoule. Okay, so by this, you can understand then that here three types of work.
We supply accumulator work inside the motor, that is the pure electrical work. It is equal to 10,800 joule, or you can say that 10.8 kilojoule. And when this electrical work is converted into mechanical energy, this mechanical energy is equal to, that is equal to 9.72 kilojoule. And if we talk about after work on the atmosphere layer to this mechanical energy, that is equal to 3.77 kilojoule. Okay,
so this is the first problem. Second problem we will discuss in next class. Okay, thank you very much.